neither sorrow nor cry, and no more pain, the former things are all passed away. He that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. He said unto me, Write these words, for they are faithful and true. And it is done. It is done.
Is he the Son of Man, seed of Abraham, second person in the Trinity? He is the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the Son of God, the King of Kings, Lord of Lords. He's everything. Messiah, Jehovah, Prince of Peace is he. Son of Man, seed of Abraham, second person in the Trinity. He is the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the Son of God, the King of Kings, Lord of Lords. He's everything. Messiah, Jehovah, the Prince of Peace is he. The Son of Man, seed of Abraham, second person in the Trinity. Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the Son of God, the King of Kings, Lord of Lords, He's everything. Messiah, Jehovah, the Prince of Peace is He, the Son of Man, the Seed of Abraham, second person of the Trinity. He is the Alpha and Omega.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the
even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. Thou turnest man to destruction and sayest, Returning children of men, for 1,000 years in thy sight are but as yesterday when it was past, and as a watching night. Thou carest them away as with a cloud. They are as asleep in the morning, they are like grass which groweth up. In the morning it flourisheth and groweth up. In the evening it is cut down and withereth. For we are consumed by thine anger, and by thy wrath are we troubled. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go and prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself. And there I am. There indeed he was.
This afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, we as friends and colleagues have come to support this family in this send-off, to celebrate the life of a mother, a loved one, and a great Christian. I invite you to join voices together as we sing, "The golden morning is fast approaching. Jesus soon will come to take his faithful and happy children to their promised home."
The golden morning is fast approaching. Jesus soon will come to take his faithful and happy children to their promised home. Oh, we see the glimpse of the golden morning piercing through this life of gloom. Oh, we see the glimpse of the golden morning that will burst the gloom. The gospel so much will soon be carried to the nations from the bridegroom that
will cease to tarry and the trumpet sound.
For we see the glimpse of the golden morning piercing through this night of gloom. For we see the glimpse of the golden morning that will burst the gloom. Attend them by all the shining angels round the flaming sky. The judge will come and take his people where they will not die. For we see the gleams of the golden morning piercing through this night of gloom. For we see the gleams of the golden morning that will burst the gloom. If those loved ones who have long been parted will only that day, the tears of those who are broken hearted will be wiped away. For we see the gleams of the golden morning piercing through this night of gloom. For we see the gleams of the golden morning
that will burst the gloom.
On the program, on that part is told. His colleague and friend, and feeding for him instead of the family members. We bow heads as we pray. Dearest Father in heaven, this afternoon, how blessed we are to be still alive, to meet here in this service celebration and thanksgiving. We have come here, mighty God, to express in a profound way our thanks to you for the life and death of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Because he died and rose again, even in the face of death, we can have hope. And so we commend to your love and care the bereaved family members. Let them understand that you are the omnipotent God. Now that needs to be done for them, you can do adequately. Thank you for their life, with the part of Sister Gwendolyn Allen. A truly noble Christian lady she was. She had left for the family members a great legacy. Nothing of that can be compared to a knowledge of heaven's God. Blessed one shall speak to us on your behalf. May the spoken word beget new life in us, so as we continue to live from day to day, we'll do so knowing that one day soon you shall come and you will claim unto yourself your faithful people. Bless the afternoon's proceedings. We saw the participants. We pray in your son's name. Amen. Amen. Be seated.
Thank you very much, Pastor Wilton Bygrave. I greet you well, ladies and gentlemen, and ask you to pay attention to the following. One, the family at great expense has provided a guide for this afternoon's program. If you're on the program, we're asking you to follow and stand enough, close enough, so that when your item comes, you can just unannounced. Three, someone thing that the family wanted done at this program. So if you are on to do a song, just come and sing. Don't bother with the speech. Somebody is appointed to do everything that the family desires done. And finally, so when you come, stand up, speak up, and shut up. The program will flow, as I said, unannounced, ladies and gentlemen, and we are going to ask the Justin Allen grandson to get us started with the scripture reading.
Can we stand for the scripture reading? The scripture reading is taken from 1 Peter 1, verse 3 and 4. If you haven't seen it, he is the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which, according to his abundant mercy, has begotten us again until the living hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth away, not away, reserved in heaven for you. This is a reading of the Lord.
Amen.
Okay. I've been instructed on a few things which I would like to bring to your attention. Number one, I had the privilege of serving here as the pastor, and I have had my stint interacting with Sister Allen. And while I served here, Sister Allen was not one of those front page persons who take over and run things. She operated, under the radar. But she was a tower of strength. She was a very spiritually strong person who always shore up the pastor with her prayer and her encouragement backstage, outside. When you visit with her, she always gives you the assurance of her prayer and gives you the strength and fortitude of her encouragement. And so these are the kinds of people whose actions are not detected and celebrated, but their actions are priceless. And so we want to say that we have lost a stalwart in this church here. And we are thankful that she left two legacies. One is the children that she bred, who have embraced the faith and are growing in grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And the second is the fond memories that she has left for those of us who have interacted closely with her. Those of you who are here to support a friend who might be an offspring from this family, we sympathize with you that you did not have the privilege of meeting the real deal. So if you are here because you know Gary, but you didn't know his mother, you missed the better part. Right? So if you are here because of what trickled down into Gary and Steve, and five sons. If you are here because you know them, you missed the real deal. but we can celebrate with you that, you know, to live in the hearts of those you leave behind is to never die. And so we cherish the fond memories that she has left for us, and we encourage the family that she would not want you to mourn like those without hope, because we have this hope that burns within our hearts that one of these days graves and columbariums and sepulchres will give up the bodies of those who died in the Lord, and then the reunion will begin. Amen. May we all be faithful until that day. The next item on the program is a musical tribute by Andrew Edwards.
We all will be going to see the King. It won't be long.
It won't be long.
Soon we'll
there, Lord. Amen. Today I'll be reading Job 19, verse 25 to 27. For I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin worm destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and mine eyes shall behold, and not another. This is the word of God.
Amen. Greetings, everyone. Good morning. Happy Mother's Day. So my name is Cayman. I'm the, I guess, one of the nephews representing the fifth sibling. And you know, as we come here today, instead of Gwendolyn Allen, we celebrate her life. Because as the pastor said, you know, she was a quiet person. Off the radar, I believe, was the words that he used. And even as a nephew, being born in America, but I spent many years, many summers. If school wasn't in, I was up here in the river, right here in country. All right. So she definitely touched my life. She didn't say much, but when she spoke, she just had a way of it just resonated. It just resonated, you know. And even, you know, to this day, you know, many of the things she said to me, even of late, you know, we spoke. It was short conversations. But you ever have a relationship with a person when they just say a little bit, but it just stick? You understand? That's the type of relationship we had, you know. And she taught me some things, a lot of things. Definitely about working in the shop there. And I don't even know if you guys even realize that. I didn't realize that until, you know, as I grow older, then I thought, wait a minute, this is where I learned to sell. In the shop. You know, and you know, again, that's just one of those things you don't realize how people impact you until you get older. And you now, you know, approaching 40 and being a business owner in the States, and you know, a lot of that I do have to attribute to Ms. Gwendolyn Allen, my aunt. So I definitely wanted to just say that, you know, we're celebrating her life. She's left an impact to more than just her five sons. She touched the entire family. Because at the end of the day, this place was like the staple. This is like where the whole family came. No matter what, you know, fifth cousin, first cousin, it didn't matter. Brother, son, you know, granddaughter, grandson, this is where we all came. So in the spirit of keeping things short, I'm gonna wrap it up there. And just a last thing I'd just like to say, just put your phones on vibrate or silent, because I heard a few phones ringing back there. All right, and let's keep the program rolling. All right.
Thank you, sir. And Father Nephew. Father Nephew is coming.
You know, Auntie's gone, so my message is to my cousins. One love. When you're weary, feeling small, when tears are in your eyes, I will try them all. I'm on your side. Oh, time it rolls, and friends just can't be found, like a bridge over troubled water. I will lay me down, like a bridge over troubled water. Yeah.
belongs to the world. Sit on by. Your time has come to shine, and all your dreams are on the way. See how they shine. Oh, if you need a friend, I'm sailing right behind, like a bridge over troubled water. I'll ease your mind, like a bridge over troubled water. I will ease your mind. I will ease.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's indeed a privilege to stand in this capacity, in spite of this sad occasion, and to say, especially on behalf of the member and pastor of the church, to really bury a mother on Mother's Day is not easy. But the truth is, we know that death will soon be gone. And there's coming a time when there will be pain-free. Crime will be free. We'll be free of all those things. And I say to the dearly beloved family members, friends, well-wishers, relatives, that not long from now, death will be a thing of the past. For what? Christ is coming soon. To rule forever. We'll be pain-free, sorrow-free, crime-free, and we'll be free at last. I have known Sister Allie for many years. As a matter of fact, I know her before she started coming to this church. Back then in the days of early Adventism in this community, I recall that at lunchtime, when this church was in a zinc building, over by Brother Reed, Uncle Dean was like headquarters where, you know, many of the leaders and other members congregate for lunch and a Sabbath afternoon. I recall also that she used to carry the boys, she used to say in those days, the boys, yes. Gary, Keith, and Steve. And I learned also that there were bigger ones, but I've never met them. However, she was such a neat person that the boys that she took with her then, they were so neatly attired. Okay, Sister Helen, you know, she will be sadly missed because, you know, coming on a Sabbath, looking over on my left, you would see her sitting in the second row. And most occasion, the second row. And when we meet her outside, she would always have something to say in her so soft-spoken way. And it is true that we really and truly miss her. I won't be long. But to say that our seat will be empty. Just the Sabbath before she passed, I happened to talk to her on her veranda. And I really and truly did know that that would be my last talk with her. It is so sad. She lived an exemplary life before her Creator. An example of such was encouraging her late husband to be an Adventist. She's sleeping, and her life and work won't be forgotten. I say to all the children, be courageous, be faithful to God, Your mom loved you, and personally, I can tell you, she spoke proudly of her boys. Even that girl she raised, members, friends, well-wishers, and those of the community, as said, she's gone but not forgotten. So I say, sleep on, Sister Ali, until that blessed day when Jesus shall come to take his children home. To the bereaved family, be faithful, be hopeful till then. Seek not for the things of this world, for there's things are going to be better on the other shore. Be faithful.
Amen.
I first want to say thanks God for allowing us to see another day, the pastors and members of this church, and of course to all the friends and family who comes out here to say goodbye to her mom. One thing I can always remember about my mom, I'm speaking from the heart. I write something here, but I can't read it right now. The one thing I know she always, every time I talk to her, she says, Henry, you're my first son. I love all of you guys. Make sure all of you guys get along. One thing I'm remiss is hearing, boy, you look just like your mom. And you're gonna be lucky. I call it blessing. I'm blessed to have my brothers here with me. We have another brother. He couldn't make it for whatever reason it was, but he's still a brother. I just want to say also, happy Mother's Day to all the mothers who came out today. It's your day. Happy Mother's Day, Mom. I'm gonna always love you. We gonna always love you. Sleep in peace. Until we see you again. Blessing. Amen.
Well, my brother eloquently said most of what I could have said here this afternoon. But what you don't know is that my mom, our mom, was a comedian. And we had a lot of laughter in that house. You know, one of the popular sayings in Sunderland was that Miss Gwen spoiled her boys.
Amen.
Now, I don't know whether it's true or not, but to this day, none of us can climb a tree. When we needed coconut, we had to call the Ramsey girls. My old mom loved to play, and to this day, Steve loved to play with his mother's breasts. And you may even see a picture today of proof of Steve. Yes. My mother always encouraged us to be better, or to strive for the best. Well, you don't know about my mother, even though she was small, didn't say much, but when she said something, resonant. But she also had the gift of getting anybody to do anything. I waited at the airport for the first time she was coming in New York, and I'm saying, man, my mom's gonna be in trouble with all those suitcases coming in. And I looked, I saw this young man struggling with three suitcases. I said, Mom, what happened? He says, I knew I had to carry this suitcase, so I'd make friends with somebody. You know, Mom was a tough cookie, trust me. You have to be tough to raise all of this. None of us got in trouble. Okay, so maybe a few times. In fact, not only did we not get in trouble, none of us had any trouble with the law. On the other side, three of us at least became law enforcement officers. And that stands to the testament of my mother. But I must tell you a little bit of a story behind this choice in jobs. My two older brothers were already police in Kingston. And when I decided I want to join the force as well, my mother came to church and got the whole church to fast so I couldn't pass the test. You know, there's too much to tell about my mother. But one thing I can tell you is that my mother does the extraordinary things. Like once, I think Steve and I, we took her to Mother's Day luncheon. And after the lunch was done, I said, Steve, where's Mom? And all of a sudden, look on the stage, and my mother was on the stage giving thanks. Nobody asked her, but she felt it was just her place to say thank you. And so in the spirit of our mom, I want to say thank you and happy Mother's Day.
Those who know me, I'm not really a talker, but I just want to say one thing. I want to say, regarding our mother, you know, like Gary said, raising boys, you know. I remember when we were younger and we are well through the week, but comes Friday afternoon, then all of us are got, you know, start getting some sort of sniffles and getting sick and all of that. You know, because of course we didn't, at that age, the boys get to play on Saturday, we didn't get that chance. We feel like we're missing out, so we feel like it's, we're sick on Sabbath. You know, but thankfully our mom saw through that. And then we had to come to church with her, and we thank her, you know, that she raised us up, that we can get to know the Lord, and that we can continue that legacy. Just like my mom, I don't have much. So thank you guys.
Tears from the stars. Yes, it Mama, I just want you to know, loving you is like food to my soul.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Oh. You're always down for me, have always been around for me, even when I was bad. You've shown me right from my wrongs. Yes, you did. And you took up for me when everyone was down on me. You always did understand. You gave me strength to go on.
There was so times looking back when I was so afraid, and then you come to me and tell me I could face anything, and no one else can do what you've done for me. You'll always be, you will always be the girl in my life. Ooh, oh.
Mama, Mama.
I hope it's worth all the pain.
to say goodbye to yesterday. And I'll take with me the memories to remind the child of the rain. It's so hard to say goodbye. God is able, God is able, and he won't fail. God is able, God is able, God won't fail. Tell me who can make a mountain move out of my way, and who can make a miracle because of my faith. And when the doctor says no, who can still say yes? And when I'm in trouble, who's right there to help me pass every test? God is able, God is able, God is able, oh, and he won't fail. Tell me who can make stream, and who can tell the clouds to roll back so that the sun can look at me? And who can tell the wind to whistle through the trees? And when I'm in trouble, who's that same God that will come down and rescue me? God is able, God is able, and he won't fail, no. Never forsake you. No, he won't fail. He'll be there till the end. God won't fail. He won't fail.
When God lifts his veil of love in my heart and write my soul a message he wants me to know. He is spirit, so divine, set the sinful soul on fire. Hallelujah. When God lifts his love in my heart. Where? I said I couldn't
tell it to a living soul. I've got salvation and he made me whole.
How I could I
hide such love of Jesus in my heart? Laugh and he made me cry,
set my sinful soul on fire. When
God dips his love in my heart,
and of all the way seems very dark and cold, and trouble surrounds me and keeps me from my goal. I'll go to God in prayer, and I know I'll find him there. He whispers.
Thank you.
that kept her family together. And that she could get the boys through the stage where they would fake illness, through to church, through the years, to the point where in teenage years, they made church their choice. Because you would agree, knowing Sister Allen physically, she was small. If those boys didn't want to go to church during their teenage years, she couldn't get them to. She was soft-spoken, mild-mannered. But they loved church and they loved Jesus. And her godly influence was such that they chose her God to be their God. That's a great tribute to her life and her godly influence as a mother. And by the time they chose their paths and left her roof, long before there was a Facebook, you didn't have to ask how they were doing or how the children were doing. Sister Allen had her album and she kept you abreast. You didn't need Facebook, you never had Facebook, but she kept you. She kept their faces before you. And her influence as a mother was strong. My mother, this tribute would have been more fitting from her friend. My mother was her friend. They grew up together even before they started having children. So there was Donna and Gary, and then there was Maxine and Steve, and Steve and my brother Steve and me. So that's how we grew. Sabbath afternoons when we went for lunch, and as my mother reminded me, Brother Donna would say, he was then our first elder, "Mothers, you are not growing the children right. Why? It's mango time. You can't tell children not to go and pick up mango, even if it's Sabbath." Oh, we just had to, and the plum tree was out there in his yard. We just had to hear the plums fall, and we'd be out of there. No plums would stay under the tree. And when we got here under that tree there, and when there was no mangoes, and the lime tree was down there, we would strip it, and we would eat those limes. And so but those were the only kind of trouble we gave as children. And their influence, hers and all the adults that were there shepherding us and guiding us, they led us to accept that church wasn't just about fun, it was about a life of commitment. And thank God, her influence, along with my mother and all those mothers, have helped us to be the adults we are today. It's a tribute to her life, the lives of those in church then. And I trust that now that she's gone, that group is gone, that they would have, Gary, Steve, and the others, you would have found your own group to keep you together as family. That's important. So you might not meet again at her house, but you will have your own meeting spot. And at last, may this tribute, may her life and her memory keep you focused, so that on that great getting up morning, when the saved of earth come together, we'll see her again.
Amen. Amen.
To my friend AJ, you know him as Henry. He goes back a long time. Amen. And to all the family and all the friends, this is my tribute to you all.
Yeah.
Thank you. beyond the sky. When the suffering's over, spread my wings and fly. When Jesus says it's over, oh, what joy that will be. There is no more dreaming. I'll be home at last. I've been dreaming of city Jerusalem, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. I've been dreaming of city Jerusalem, my home right up in the sky. Dreaming of the city far beyond the sky. When the suffering's over, spread my wings and fly. When Jesus says it's over, oh, what joy that will be. I'll be home at last. I've been dreaming of the city Jerusalem, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. I've been dreaming of the city Jerusalem, my home right up in the sky. I've been dreaming of the city Jerusalem, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. I've been dreaming of city Jerusalem, my home right up in the sky. My home right up in the sky.
Just know that you are are very close in every thought and prayer. May you find strength in being a loving family, warm embrace in the comfort of friends, and assurance of a family reunion at the resurrection, when Jesus initiates the new world order at the second advent. Until that experience becomes a reality, the Inter-American Division and Pastor and Sister Balvin Graham assure all of you, joy is on its way. Amen. Dr. Balvin Graham, Assistant to the President, Director of Evangelism and Leadership Development. Amen. You would have observed on your program that we will be, at this time, collecting a special offering, construction. The work is great. And so, when Seventh-day Adventist Church and your effort this afternoon, it will help to realize a more comfortable structure of our Creator and Lord. We will continue to give glory and honor to His name. And so this afternoon, we solicit your great contribution. Our the tidings will be sung as our deacons will collect this special gift.
Oh! life, we will never understand. Regardless of our age, our background, our education, our status in life, or our affiliation. We will never understand why many children die of hunger, while others waste more than they use. We will never understand why there are so many diseases and pestilences. We will also never understand why humans have little or no regards for others' lives. We will also never understand why an underdog becomes a winner. And finally, we will never understand the death of a loved one. While all these things are a mystery and beyond human comprehension, we as Christians and believers have this blessed assurance that God, He is still God, and He is in control. We also know that we serve a great God who knows the beginning from the end. He sits high and He looks low. He knows what is best for us. As a God we can always trust, I can hear Him clearly saying, you don't need to understand, you just need to hold my hand. We can also be assured like Job and believe that though worms should eat our bodies, yet in our flesh we shall see God. And our eyes shall behold Him and not another. With this blessed hope and assurance, I read the eulogy for the late Gwendolyn Maud Dillon Allen, also known as Miss Gwen, Ma, Mama, Miss Gwen, and Sis. It was 82 years ago on Thursday, October 3, 1935, in a small community in the western parish of Hanover, known as Kendall, as Milda Fletcher and her spouse welcomed their new baby girl, the eldest child in this world. They named her Gwendolyn. I wondered what inspired them to give her that name. Research revealed that the name Gwendolyn is a European name of Welsh origin that means fair and blessed. How befitting a name for a small but taller woman. Beautiful, courageous, and strong woman. Gwendolyn was the eldest of 8 siblings. All are here today except Leroy, who is deceased. After obtaining a basic education, like most of us, in the quest for greener pastures, Gwendolyn moved from Kendall, Hanover, to live and work in Montego Bay, where she met Cleveland Allen, and they begat 2 sons, Henry and Peter. She had a special love for the name Allen, because her first son was Allen, so she had a special love for the name Allen, or men named Allen, because as fate would have it, she later met and was smitten by another Allen, the late Stanford Allen, and the rest is history. She moved from Montego Bay to live in the community of Sunderland, and the union between Stanford and Gwendolyn produced 3 boys. Winston, also known as Gary, Keith, also known as Keith, and Marcel, also known as Steve. They later got married and were the Mr. and Mrs. Hyde of Sunderland. She was a dedicated wife who believed in the vows of marriage, for better for worse, through sickness and health, for richer for poorer, till death do us part. She always talked about her life and taking care of the boys. Yes. She would always say that life was never easy and would sometimes joke that she was leaving but would never attempt to pack a bag. There are many things Miss Gwen was and many things she was not. She was a devoted mother. The word devoted means loving, loyal, faithful, committed, and dedicated. This is an adjective that perfectly describes who Miss Gwen was and how she will be remembered by her children. She gave her all to and for her children, and often referred to them as the boys, and will depend on them to make any and every decision, even though she can make for herself. She was better than today's soccer mom. It is said that Miss Gwen would stop any procession to show pictures of the boys. No wonder her son Winston, or Gary, as we know him, is a professional photographer. Of a truth, the Allen family is among a few families I know that have pictures dated back to Belfort pants, gabardine, and afro. In fact, their neighbor and childhood friend Delroy Keaty Gordon, who is here today, told me that the boys have pictures so old that the back pocket is at the front. Friends, he was not lying. I am a witness. I have seen the picture. If you'd like to see this picture, check the boys, they have archived. She made our lives as wives difficult because she did everything for the boys. Even the things the boys should have done for themselves. For example, I know my mom taught me well. I grew up in the era where girls had no choice but to learn how to wash, cook, and clean, because you know what. So I have no doubt that I mastered the culinary arts. However, on my best day, my husband will tell me not a Gwen. Miss Gwen cooks well, but a village would starve if she was given the task to cater for them. Her meals, though delicious and well-planned, were morsels that would require another miracle of fish and loaves to feed more than the boys. If you have a healthy appetite, my house is not the place to go. She often says she has tried but cannot cook a lot of food. She was a dedicated wife who loved in spite of. She epitomizes true love that correlated with her faith and belief, which teaches that God is love and true love comes from God. In fact, she loved so much that she was no help to the boys in choosing soulmates. The boys always joke that in the quest for wives, they would bring girls on mini dates home for Sabbath lunch. Mom would carefully prepare the sumptuous meal and they would eat and have conversations. However, when all is said and done, they would ask, "Ma, what do you think?" And she would reply, "I like her. She's nice." I remember Steve teasing her and saying to her, "Mama, you have no help. You confuse us. How can you love every girl we bring home? It is impossible to love every girl we bring home." She would sit. She listened attentively, and then she would say in that calm, sweet voice, with a smile on her face, "It's true, I love all of them." She loved to save. She was very frugal and thrifty. She believed that whatever resources you have, especially money, should be used wisely. Hence, she would not buy the latest, and she lived a modest lifestyle. She taught the boys to save from an early age, a habit that the boys have brought into their adult life and relationships. A habit, though very important, sometimes annoys us as wives, because we sometimes do not always get our way. I remember sometimes in December 2016, Ma called and she said to Steve, "Do you know what holiday is coming up?" Steve said, "Yes, Christmas." Then she said, "You need to send me something for Christmas." Steve said, "What do you want?" And she replied, "Send me a money to put in my book." We often laugh about Ma and her memory. Why? Because as she ages, her memory for everything else dwindles, except anything and everything to do with money. She loved flowers. And wherever she went, there were flowers. She be assured she's taking a piece home. She takes pride in her garden at home, and often her late husband was security guard, as young men and children in the community play soccer or football in front of her garden. Last July, she came visiting with us, and we took her to an aquarium where they had butterflies and a garden. It was obvious that she was at home and at peace with nature. But Steve had to remind her, Ma, there are a lot of cameras. Don't take any flowers. She was not a warmonger or a busybody in other people's business. She never attempted at any time to meddle in other people's business, not even the boys, whom she loved dearly. I can speak for all the sons and daughter-in-laws. When she visits us, she's on vacation. She acts as if she's in a five-star hotel. She never opened the refrigerator door or the pantry door. She must and always be served. Ma, you can take what you want, her sons would say. And she would calmly say, this is not my house, and I cannot do as I please. Annoying as it sounds, and truly it was at times, when you see and hear of the challenges individuals are having with their in-laws and outlaws, we as daughter-in-laws have accepted our stance and have realized and appreciate that she has set for herself boundaries that she was not willing to cross and standards she was not willing to go below, and so respect is due. Whether it be her children, siblings, other family members, neighbors, or friends, her role has always been that of a peacemaker. She constantly advised the boys to live good with each other. The boys were constantly reminded of the beatitude noted in Matthew 5, especially verse 9 that says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called children of God. She was a praying mother and a wife. She would always admonish the boys, grandchildren, families, friends, and relatives to pray. At home or abroad, she was always ready to pray. In fact, whenever she visited and you miss her, she was in her room praying with her head covered. Whenever she called, she would always advise us to take care and pray always. And if she calls and we're not at home, she would leave her favorite voicemail.
Mother calling.
When you get home on Sabbath and miss her call, she would leave a voicemail. Mother calling. And this voicemail would repeat until she gets someone. And if you never answer the phone, you will get voicemail till there's no more messages. Mother calling. Oh, how we miss hearing that voice. She was a dedicated Christian woman who would open her homes to pastors, Bible workers, called porters, friends, and family. She loved her brethren and enjoyed fellowshipping with them. Sabbath to her was a joy, especially if she's around the boys and her grandchildren. Approximately 2 years and 7 months ago, Miss Gwen lost her husband and life partner, Stafford Allen. We have no doubt that she was hurting. As time elapsed, you would hear her talk about Zent in an affectionate way. That one would soon realize that she was broken. The boys not being around made it even harder. She would often call and said she's lonely, as the boys would assure her of their love. She visited as often as she could and enjoyed moving from one home to the next, spending time with the grandchildren and the boys. We believe she lived a good life, and the boys are proud to know that they were able to give back to Mom as she did to them. The norm for us is for Ma to call between Friday evening and Sunday. On Sabbath, May 25th, she did not call, and we assume that she would call on Sunday. My husband said, I wonder what happened, why Mama did not call. And for sure something was wrong. We received a call, no one wants to receive, on Monday, May 26th, that she was not feeling well and was admitted to the hospital. She was very conscious while at the hospital. She spoke with her sons and advised them that she was not feeling any pain and was going to be okay. We even got pictures of her lying on the bed in the hospital. She seemed so calm, peaceful, and contented. But little did we know that the circle would be broken. She spoke joyfully to her son, Winston, on Tuesday, March 28th, and died peacefully on Wednesday, March 29th. We as Christians, when we lose a loved one, we do not mourn like those with no hope. We celebrate knowing that we will see our loved ones again. So on this Mother's Day, I say to the boys, Henry, Peter, who's absent, Winston, Keith in the cell, though losing a loved one is never easy, take courage that losing someone the way Mom died is a blessing. She did not suffer. And after 82 years of life, she deserves to rest. So while you miss her, keep courage. Be strong and trust that you will see her again. To her siblings, Barbara, Olive, Wellesley Harris, Anthony, and Lloyd, I say to you, stay strong. To her grandchildren, let her go. She has won well, and now she must rest. To our dear family members, other families, our brethren, friends, well-wishers, she would desire that you all fear God and keep his commandments. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. At the last trump, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this mortal body must put on immortality, and this corruptible shall put on incorruptible. And when this perishable put on the imperishable, and the mortal should have put on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? Amen. Sleep on, Mama. Sleep on, Miss Gwen. Sleep and take your rest.
Amen.
Thank you.
that each individual may bear. And as a result of that, he continues to speak to us and with us. This afternoon, God has chosen a man who has been serving the Lutche Circuit of Churches for over 2 years. Now, while Sister Allen was alive, he was the serving pastor. But presently, the pastor who did the open prayer now serves this church in the circuit that is known as the Welcome Hall Circuit. However, it is most fitting that the pastor who served while Sister Allen was alive present the message to his people. And so, ladies and gentlemen, I present to you Pastor Carl Sterling, who will indeed present a message to God's people. Just before he does his presentation, we will be favored with a very special song of meditation, which will be done by A, B, C. And then D will present the word of God.
I just want to make it to heaven. I just want to make it in. Just want to cross that river. I want to be free from sin. Oh, I just want my name to be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And when this life is over, I just want to have eternal life. I just want to hear Him say, well done, well done, well done, well done, well done, well done, well done. You can come on.
Look down upon us with mercy.
come in this place, fill our hearts with the joy and the hope of your soon return. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
God has a big plan for the problem of death. And it doesn't matter who you are, where you come from, what you look like, you're going to die. It, no matter what degrees you have, what car you drive, what horse you have, or where you live, the reality is, we all are going to die. But God has a big plan for the problem of death. While on the Isle of Patmos in exile, John heard a voice in heaven. He said, John, write, blessed are the dead that die in the Lord. That's Revelation 14 and verse 13. Blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth. Yea, said the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them. God shall bring every word into judgment. And let me say this, is not all church goers are God's sheep. It is not all Christians are God's sheep. It is not what you say or profess. It's the life that you live. The Bible tells us in Matthew 25, many will be running to him. The Bible tells us, the Son of Man shall come with power and great glory. He shall gather all nations before him, good, bad, and indifferent. And then he's going to separate the sheep from the goats. Many will be running and say, Lord, Lord, we have been to church. We have been baptized. And all these other things that we're saying. And he says, depart from me. And you will not. I'm speaking to you who are alive. The dead can't hear me. While we are alive, we are whole. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. By the way, God is the source of all life. Amen. The Bible tells us when God made man, in Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, he breathed into man the breath of life. And the interesting thing is that the word for life is wind or breath. And you hear people talk, let's breathe their last breath. Or he breathed his last breath, that's life. But this life we're talking about is the divine spark that comes from God himself. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Acts chapter 4 verse 12, there's no other name given among men whereby he must be saved. So blessed are the dead that die in the Lord. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and the dead in Christ. So it matters not how you have done so well and all that. What matters is how you die. You have to die in the Lord. And you die as a Christian, as going to church and all this. Having the name of the record and any such denomination won't help you. Only Jesus saves. And to die in Jesus is to die with a life. Jesus said these words in John chapter 15 and verse 4. Abide in me, and I in you. For without me you can do nothing. So I'm talking to people who don't have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Think about it. What shall it profit you to gain the world and lose your own soul? What shall a man give in exchange? You're going to die, you know. Moses said to Israel, I put before you two things, life and death. Choose. But be like Moses. choose rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to draw the presence of sin for the sea. Joshua said, as for me and my house, we are going to serve the Lord. The Bible tells us that by man comes death. By man comes the resurrection of the dead. In Adam all died. 1 Corinthians 15, 20, 21, 22. In Adam all died, but in Christ all shall be made alive. Amen. That's the assurance that we have. So God is going to put an end to this problem of death, which we can't get accustomed to. The Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians 15, 23, the last enemy that shall die is death. Paul says, oh death, where is thy sting? Oh grave, where is thy victory? One day the skies will roll back, and he that shall come will come and will not tarry. Behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him. Some will be running away. Some will be running to him. But the question is, how shall we stand in that great day? But with Jesus we can stand. Those who have clean hands, pure hearts. Those who have made a decision to accept Jesus as their personal Savior. He that believeth and is baptized. And I'm not talking water baptism now. Many people are baptized by water. But they are baptized by the Holy Ghost. A transformed life. My sheep knows my voice, and I know my sheep. Amen. And he's come back. One hope, one shepherd. And when he comes again, the Bible tells us, John says in Revelation 22 verse 1, 21 verse 1, behold, I saw a new heaven and a new earth, and there was no more death. No pain, no cry, no sorrow. For the former things are passed away. We shall be his people, and he shall be our God. Hold fast that which you have, and let no man take away your crown. God bless you.
Mourners in the congregation to stand this time as the immediate family members will remain seated. We will have a special prayer for the bereaved family. I invite you to assume the attitude of prayer as we talk to God. Let us pray. Our gracious God and our Heavenly Father, you are the one in whom we live and move and have our being. And you are the one who created us. And you are the one who sustains us. You are the one who is touched with the feelings of our infirmities. And we come to you at this hour, O God, acknowledging that we find in you comfort. We find in you hope, especially in moments like these. the Allen's family is in mourning. Henry, Peter, Winston, Keith, Lassell, all five sons of the deceased, our beloved Sister Allen, the grandchildren, the siblings, they are in mourning, oh God, because of the reality of death. This is a sobering moment that should inform us about our own mortality. This is a sobering moment because she was taken away at a time when they least expected it. This is a sobering moment for all of us because we ought to remember that one day we too will die. But we thank you, God, that there is hope in Jesus. We thank you that He is the great life giver. We thank you that He declared, I am the resurrection, I am the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. We embrace your promises on behalf of the Alice family. I lift them up to you, God. You know their pain. You know their anxieties. You know the expectations. You know, oh God, what they are going through. And only you alone can bring to their hearts true comfort. Only you alone understand their pain. So God, be with each one individually. I lift up to you Peter, who is not here. You know the reason. You know the circumstances. I don't know where he is, oh God, but you know. Yes, Lord. I'm praying for him because I feel impressed to pray for Peter. May the rest of the family continue to trust in you as they come by here to say goodbye to their loving mom. Grandma, may they find in you, oh God, the strength to go on. May they find in you strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Because in a little while, as they will place her remains in the earth and witness the workmen as they cover up, as they see the tomb, as they we will offer the final words, and they have to go back and live without their mom, their loved one. Who else can they turn to but you, God? May they turn to you today as never before, and find in you a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. May you enfold them, embrace them, give them courage, Lord, that they will never, never forget who you are and forget that they ought to trust you for the rest of their lives. Comfort their hearts, O God. Give them that which they will need to carry on fighting the good fight, to carry on anticipating that great day, carry on until the trumpet sound, carry on until the eastern sky shall part asunder, carry on until the dead in Christ shall rise, carry
my child, come home and be with me. May it be a grand reunion, oh God. May it be a grand celebration, not only for them, but for all of us. Until then, Lord, keep us faithful. May we keep pressing on the upward way. Until the day when we see you face to face and we hear from your lips the welcome home. May this be our experience, Lord, as you continue to take charge of our lives. In Jesus' name I pray, and let the church of God say.
Sitting there in the song that keeps playing in my mind is that no man is an island, no man stands alone. Each man is my brother, each man my friend. I might not be getting it right, but we need each other. And that's about as much as I think I can remember right this minute. But this signifies what this song is about. Because we really couldn't do it on our own. And so I, on behalf of the family, I just want to say thank you. This is a hard time, but when there are people around who can lend support, it makes it so much easier to bear. And so we just want to say thank you. I heard it said recently that a person's, the world is your house. And if I were to narrow down mom's world, it would have been her immediate family, her extended family, church, her church family, and our neighbors. And that's us, that's all of us. Our world is here. For the most part, our world is here. And we just want to say thank you so much. We can't call all the names, but there are some people over our hands and feet when we couldn't be here, and we just have to say thank you. We have to say their names. I want to mention Anne Bowling and her husband. And we thank you so much from the bottom of our hearts. You have our undying gratitude. We thank Dawn, Marcia Ramsey and family. You know when Zen died and the boys and the grandchildren and the daughter-in-law, and we couldn't be here. You know, they really stepped in, and they were always close. And they really played a part to make sure that mom felt that she was not alone. That they were always there. There are times when mom would be there, that mom sleep the night, or and was not and had to get a day off. They were there, and so we thank you so much. I want to mention Janet Lewin Griffith. You might not know her, but she's here. And she has been tremendously helpful. She ran back and forth here and there, and she never complained. And when I saw her last night, and I said, thank you so much. She said, that's what friends are for. And I just want to say thank you so much. My church family, mom's church family, thank you. Brother Gordon and his team, the ones were there to make sure the grave was dug and the things were done in order. Thank you, thank you, thank you. You know, last summer, mom came to New York and
play guitar.
We never thought that was the last time we'll see her. But I distinctly remember one morning we were having worship. And the boys. And she looked at us, all of us, and she said, "Children, remember, when you wake up in the morning, the first thing you must say is, 'Good morning, Father.'" And she wanted to make sure that we all got it. So she looked at Keith, she looked at me, and she said, "Okay, you didn't hear me, Jason, Justin," and she called everybody's name. "When you wake up in the morning, say, before you do anything else, say, 'Thank you, Father.'" And so I want to leave that with my brothers, my husband, my son, my sister-in-law, my nieces and nephews, and my extended family, and other relatives. I didn't think she was just saying, she just wanted to leave it there and say, "Thank you, or good morning, Father." She wanted to make sure that we started our days right, that we connected to God every morning, and that we maintain the connection throughout the day. And so for us, Mom is gone, and one day soon we'll see her. But let us keep that connection with God so that when Jesus comes, we will see her again. And so again, I want to say thank you. God is good. Everything works for a purpose. Sometimes we don't know everything. But I want to close by thanking God for Mom's life and for the legacy that she has left behind, the influences that she has left behind. And we know that if we live that influence and God is living for us, then really we have a hope that nobody can take from us, because one day soon we'll be reunited. So thank you again. God bless you. And we just appreciate everything, every shoulder, every hand. God bless.
Amen.
As we bring this program to an end, I would like you to give attention to these instructions.
from Blackie Rasta.
Lifted high to mock, despised to rail. A sacrifice that finally would never falter. Where heaven's grace unlocked those gates of hell. Free at last. Free at last. Guilt with sin is buried in our past. Home is in our eyes. Faith is on the rise. From Satan's grasp. Praise the Lamb. Free at last. Sin had watched this gruesome scene too often. Hell must have thought it's only blood and nothing more. Cause rusty nails could never seal Satan's coffin. Ah, but when he saw those grave clothes on the floor, free at last, I'm free at last. Guilt with sin is buried in our past. Home is in our eyes. Faith is on the rise. From Satan's grave. Praise the Lamb. I'm free at last. Free at last. We're free at last. Guilt with sin is buried in our past. Home is in our eyes. Faith is on the rise. From Satan's grasp. Praise the Lamb. I'm free at last. Home is in our eyes. Faith is on the rise. From Satan's grasp. Praise the Lamb. Oh yes, I want to praise the Lamb. I'm free at last.
The trumpet of the Lord shall sound and turn no more, and in turn, bright and fair,
and the chains of earth shall gather
over on the others, and the roses fly yonder at the day. Everybody chorus. When the road
is all up yonder.
When the road is all up yonder. When the road is all up yonder. When the road is all up yonder, I'll be there. From the master, from the dawn is setting sun.
And
the roll is called up yonder on the bed. When the roll is called up yonder. When the roll is called up yonder.
When the roll is
called up yonder. When the roll is called up yonder on the bed. Let us bow our heads. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for life, and we thank you for the blessed hope that one day death will be no more. We pray that as we make our last respect and commit this, our dear seed to the ground, that you will bless all the family members who are here and those who are witnessing. May we make a decision to be on the side of Jesus. We pray that you keep us faithful until that day. In his name we pray.
Amen.
Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Inasmuch as God in his tender mercies has permitted our dear sister Gwendolyn Allen to fall asleep, we do now tenderly commit her body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, with the hope of a joyous resurrection. We'll continue singing as the sepulchre is sealed.
Passing by, come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus and live. Now your burden's lifted and carried far away, and the precious blood has washed away the stain. Now sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus and live. Like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl. But remember when we walk, sometimes we fall. So fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus and live. Sometimes the way is lonely and steep and filled with pain. So if your sky is dark and pours the rain, then cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus and live. when you can't contain your joy inside. Then dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus. So with your final heartbeat, kiss the world goodbye. Then go in peace and rest on glory's side.
Let's now bow our heads as we pray, as we have the closing benediction. Loving Lord, we thank you that you are the giver of all good gifts. And as we lay our rest to rest, our dear sister, be with the family, keep us all faithful, and at last when you come, save us, we pray, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you for coming.
So rest in Jesus, rest in Jesus, rest in Jesus, and live. Rest in Jesus. Jesus, rest in Jesus and live.